Today we have a wonderful conversation. I think this topic has not been talked about enough, maybe never talked about before, at least not that I can remember, but it's going to be talked about here today. And on this episode, I got a good group of guys on this here panel. We're going to talk about Christianity and entertainment, specifically rap music. Of course, rap music has a is pretty popular in our culture, and we just want to see if we can at least open the door to find some sort of ground of balance, some middle ground on this particular subject, and hopefully it'll be able to benefit all of those who listen. So we're going to go ahead and let these guys introduce themselves. We're going to start here on my right. Cam, if you don't mind, man, just go ahead and introduce yourself. Tell us who you are, what you do, where you live, things of that nature.
Hi, my name is Cameron Freeman. I'm originally from Montgomery, Alabama. I'm a 2008 graduate of the MIPS School of Preaching. I've been preaching now for about 15, 16 years. I'm currently working with the East Haven Church of Christ in Memphis, Tennessee. I've been here for almost 8 years now, and I'm thankful to be a part of the podcast tonight.
All right, man. Good to have you, Cam. To Lima, if you would.
My name is Lima. I'm from Hawaii, and I'm here as the minister of the Honolulu Church of Christ. I'm a 2017 graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching. Grateful to be here.
All right. And Ron, I got you next, man.
My name is Ron Sanders, originally from Rockford, Illinois. Matter of fact, that's where I was blessed to meet Cameron. 2013 graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching. Been preaching for 10 years. I'm currently laboring at the Northeast Church of Christ in East Point, Michigan. And glad to be here as well.
I'm loving it, man. We all spread out. That's good. That's good. Key, you're next.
My name is Key Ford. I'm a 2015 graduate of Memphis School of Preaching. I was a wraparound to that class. I ended up leaving in 16, but walked with the first guys. I am the minister at the Auburn Hills Church of Christ in Woodbury, Tennessee. I've been here 5 years. I've been preaching for, I don't know how long I've been preaching per se, but had a passion for it and went to school and was blessed to meet this good group of guys here. And also on my side life, I'm a counselor or a therapist. So, and just enjoying that work and combining with the ministry work, man, it's been a blessing.
All right, cool, man. Hey, look, I'm glad to have you guys on the panel. Key, do you host your own podcast too, or?
Yes, me and Lima both actually have podcasts on the Scattered Abroad Network. I said it right. My mind started to slip a little bit. I have a podcast that's called Mental Health Wealth. One of the things that I try to do, try to incorporate the mental health side into the Bible teaching, because we have so many people who have a fear of therapy and have a fear of just talking about certain things, but so many of our congregations are plagued with anxiety, depression, homes are not right. And one of the biggest killers that I see among the brethren, unfortunately, pornography. So things like that we need to talk about, and we need to have that space to help people come out of those things and not just beat them down, but to help them come out, to really bear one another's burdens and to be able to hold each other accountable and do it the correct way. So that's what I would like to do with my counseling side, is to go ahead and open my own practice so that I can help the congregations to learn more about that.
Okay, cool, man. Lima, if you would, tell us about your podcast.
Yeah, my podcast is a monthly podcast on Scattered Abroad. It's called Ohana, and Ohana in Hawaiian language, it means family. And really the focus of it, it's talking about right now in this season, I'm talking about the Lord's family, but eventually I'll cover, our relationship as God's family with God, our relationships within the family of God, and our relationship as the family of God with the world around us. So.
Hey, sounds good, man. Well, of course, everybody that was going to listen to the episode, you can tell right off the bat that we got a group of talented men here. So we got a bunch of guys who's diving into various areas of life and sort of combining that with their preaching. Of course, just want to give an update of where I am in life right now. As opposed to when I talked about on, I think, the previous three episodes. So Right now, I'm in my second semester at University of Nebraska in Omaha. Of course, I'm trying to reach my ultimate goal, which is either get into the area of physical therapist or take the different route to occupational therapist. But right now, school is going well. It's very challenging, of course. The wife and I are expecting number two. And so number two is a girl. And so we're looking forward to welcoming her on June 2nd, if she so chooses to, you know, have that as her due date. But right now, that's what the doctors are. They're predicting that it's going to be June 2nd. So we're looking forward to that. And just a lot of changes that's about to happen once again. So transitions. But nevertheless, I'm looking forward to it, man. It's going to be it's already exciting, but it's going to be more exciting as the months come. So thank you guys so much for being on the podcast. Look forward to having the conversation. And of course, the topic at hand is Christianity and entertainment, or Christian and entertainment, specifically rap music. And so we're just going to go ahead and dive into this and get this intro out the way. Now, of course, I think all of us know that over the years that there have been some very strong opinions that have been shared about rap music, some in favor of rap music, others that are opposed to rap music. I mean, if you've read on Google about, you know, various thoughts that have been shared on rap music, it has been identified as the language of a generation without fathers. I think McCray said that. And then you had Geraldo Rivera, who stated that rap music is essentially the detriment, which has done more damage to Black and brown people than racism has. And I think a prominent rapper now, Kendrick Lamar, responded to that in one of his songs. So if there exists some middle ground in this genre of music, it doesn't seem that it has been discovered yet. And so that's what I'm hoping our conversation is at least going to lead us towards. I'm not saying that it's going to get us there today, because it's just too much, I think, to cover in one conversation, but I hope it could at least serve as the launching pad. And so for each of these questions, we're just going to go around. If you don't have any input in it, which I'm hoping everyone does, but if you don't, you can defer to the person, to the next person. That's totally fine. But I'm just going to go ahead and jump into the first one. I mean, I think the best way to at least get the conversation started is to ask the first question: what is hip-hop/rap? And we're talking about its origin, its purpose, et cetera. So we're going to start on my right. We're going to start with Cam. Cam, what do you think about that question?
I guess from a historical standpoint, you know, hip-hop, you know, was kind of a collective term, you know, incorporating, you know, just different elements of, I mean, not so much street life, but just things that minorities were facing in New York, particularly when it first started. And then, you know, you can look this stuff up, man, you know, and we've seen it, you know, across the board in movies, you know, it wasn't just rapping, you know, when it first came out. It was DJing, it was scratching, it was breakdancing, graffiti, rhyming, and you know, just even inclusive of nightlife, you know, and just poetry. So it was many different elements, but then over time, just like anything else, you know, it evolved, you know, to other facets. And so now, you know, you go from, you know, the 70s up to now, nearly 40-50 years later, it's like, man, when you say rap or hip-hop, man, you're not talking about one particular thing. You're talking about a whole right. System, so a whole genre, with sub-genres under it, you know what I'm saying? So that's kind of like anything else, man. It, you know, everything evolves. Even I say this, and then I let someone else speak, but even like when you think about like pop music, you know, I'm not trying to get out of our discussion, but I mean, pop is even evolved. You right. Know, there was a time where, you know, pop was just, you know, popular music and dominated predominantly by Caucasians. But now, man, some songs that we would consider R&B are in pop categories. So, you know, the evolution of music, man, everything is kind of, you know, kind of get, you know, inclusive one another just based on who's listening to it.
Yeah, thank you, man. I think those thoughts are perfect. I always looked at it now as sort of like this umbrella term, and it's obviously inclusive of so many other things, but Talim, if you would, what do you think about the question?
I mean, that's how we start off defining our terms. And so I looked up in a dictionary, right? Because I'm a little bit ignorant when it comes to the history of rap music. So I looked it up, and it's like, as Cameron spoke, it started in New York and and originated within the African-American people, community. And the thing that stood out for me is this definition, rap music as a musical style in which rhythmic or rhyming speech is chanted. Now, I come from the island culture, and I'm familiar with chanting, right? We do hakas, is what we call it. And usually hakas are like a way of expressing ourselves and a way of expressing pain or expressing victory and things alike. So to me, I may be culturally removed from the origin of rap music, but there's chanting in it, and I can relate to that, right? Because that's where my culture comes from. And so for me, I love rap music and wasn't raised in the church. And so my choice of music was poor, you know, across the board in different genres. The types of music I listen to is different now, of course, because, of transformation, but it's still the same genre. I still like the same genre of rap music.
Man, I think that's an interesting take on the chanting part. Of course, I mean, whenever preparing for a podcast, you want to look up stuff, and whenever preparing for anything, you want to look up your terms. But yeah, I saw that too, man. I never would have thought of that until you mentioned it. It is, and I think rap music would be inclusive of the expression of pain or some situation in life that the artist obviously is going through, or there's the expression of their situation. So yeah, I think that was an interesting take on that, man. Thank you. Ron, what do you think about the question?
You know, the two terms, hip hop and rap, they're generally always mentioned together. And of course, because the two terms are connected. But the term hip hop, it really just speaks to the overall culture, you know, of a particular neighborhood and people who were living in that particular neighborhood. So I would say primarily African-Americans and Latinos, you know, to their culture. So you think about if you say a hipster today, right? If you say hipster, part of what you're going to think about is how they look, how they dress, you know, tight pants, colorful shoes. Again, the term connected to their culture. So that's what hip hop was supposed to be. It was attached to a specific culture of people living in a specific neighborhood, specific boroughs in New York. And rap was the voice to that. You know, and so Cameron mentioned it, you know, DJing, you know, the mixing, the graffiti, the scratching. And just having this platform, you know, to express the hardships of certain situations, you know, things that are not so easy to talk about, living in impoverished neighborhoods, looking for better days, you know, looking for hope. I mean, that's hip hop and rap, and I would say in its origin. And of course, as you know, Brother Freeman alluded to, of course, over time it has evolved. But again, going back to the origin of it, that's what hip hop and rap is meant to be.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Hip hop, the culture, rap, the voice of that culture. That's dope. That's dope. Key, what's your take on the question?
You know, to kind of piggyback off what Ron is saying, when you look at it in its whole totality, because you have to realize how people came together. If it was breakdancing, if it was somebody DJing, if it was somebody who made the beat, if it was somebody who wrote the raps, it was all a collective for that community in a way of expressing oneself. And just like anything, you know, as we already stated, that over time it does transform and it does kind of loses where it comes from. But if we're looking back at the essence of it, of where it started from the house parties, you know, I'm from Mississippi, I'm from the South, I'm from the deep South. And so I always love the fact of when we were growing up, we used to go to the projects and Saturday morning blues party. All those things sprung from the hip hop culture. You know, if you got hip hop, blues, and all these things, because blues went from 6 to 10, and then guess what? You had the hip hop hours come on from 11 to 2. And it was just all good music that people were dancing to. It was feel good, it was have fun. And the even if you take it back to the Bronx in New York and to see how they started, you know, the battling, you know, it was all about, again, telling a story. You know, I look at it, it would be no different than us reading Shakespeare. It's how Shakespeare told his stories. Rap, hip hop, whichever avenue you want, whichever car you want to call it by and you want to ride in, that's what it is. It's a storytelling event.
I love it. So go ahead.
I would just that I can't remember the title. I mean, maybe it's about the brand name of the title of the movie up, but I mean, you clearly saw that in the movie with Taye Diggs and Sanaa Lathan.
Brown Sugar.
Brown Sugar. When you know he was a record, and he was a record exec, and you know he kept looking for talent, you know, modern day talent, you know, 2000-ish, and he couldn't find true hip hop. So he wanted like, and in the movie he kept talking about, man, you know, he missed that old school vibe when it was about poetry, was about rhyming, where it was about, you know, saying the essence of music, and it wasn't really about, you know, the criminal element and the stuff that we now see, but it was just about, like you said, what it was originally when it first came out.
Right, and I love it, man. If I had to sum it all up, I guess it would be, you know, this mode of expression of storytelling by a specific group of people, obviously that has, at least what I'm hearing, that has sort of lost its way over time. So we definitely want to dive a little bit deeper into maybe how it has evolved and maybe give some clarity to people who are a little bit confused about it, or to just be frank, people who just downright hate rap music. So we want to get into the nitty gritty of this. So when we talk about this genre of music, I think it's no secret that rap music has been highly criticized in academic classrooms. I mean, I've had professors to, you know, sort of joke about it and talk about it in a very, you know, sort of demoralizing way, and just making fun of the people that listen to it. I've heard it criticized from pulpits. I've heard over and over again rap music being like the illustration and sort of like the poster child of just sin in general by various preachers. So it's something that I think has been highly criticized. But then more so than that, if I just had to get into some of the things that people have stated about it, number one, if you've ever heard, I think Lecrae was the first person to mention something about this, but he mentioned that if we choose to promote things like misogyny and like the crimes of the Italians back in the day and make them heroes, you know, then we can't really, we're making a subjective standard in our country, and so then anybody who doesn't live up to that standard is considered a villain, but those who uphold the standard is considered a hero. And so he's thinking that it's more so subjective, and the view that people have over rap music when specifically speaking about the negative portion of it. But then one lady, I think she's a lawyer, and let me see, can I grab her name real quick? But Karis Cooper, she actually had to defend a young black male on trial who was on trial for his rap lyrics. And of course, in his lyrics, they believe it to be a terrorist threat because he had something about a gun and killing, you know, and shooting and taking someone's car and stuff like that. So she had to defend the guy. And she said she realized after reading the words that they were lyrics, they were an expression. They weren't actually the guy, you know, wanting to commit some terrorist act. And she thought she did a wonderful job to the jury, who was predominantly all white. But she thought she was doing a good job in front of the jury, but they ultimately convicted the guy. He was sent to jail for like 5 or 6 years because of his lyrics. And she stated that she actually did a project where she took the lines of a similar song, similar rap song, and she told one group it was from a country song and another group that it was from a rap song. And when she did that, the group who was told that it was from a country song, a rap song, deemed it as more villainous than the group did for who heard that it was from a country song. So I mean, let's talk about this. I mean, why is this genre of music regarded so negatively in society? Cam, I'm going to start with you.
Well, I would say, you know, man, number one, it's you know, if we're being frank and we're being direct, you know, any genre of music that you listen to contains the same elements. You know, you listen to country music, you listen to pop music, you listen to R&B, you know, they have elements of sinful activity. You know, it's just that, you know, rap and hip hop gets the bad end of the stick from the standpoint of it's more direct, it's more in your face. And what I mean by that is, you know, you see the rappers, you see the guys with their big jewelry, with their cars, you know, the clothing, because the music is so direct and the content that's behind it is so direct and in your face. The music is louder, So you hear the lyrics, you hear exactly what they're saying. But as opposed to if we're going to say they don't talk about that in country, man, we'd be lying. But it's just the fact that it is so direct when it comes to rap, and it's so loud and in your face and up close and personal. It gets a bad connotation from that light. But then just think about over the years, it's been things from a political standpoint, man, when Bone Thugs and Harmony came out. One of the things they highlighted in one of their songs was, the president or some powerful person was saying, we're not against, rap, but we are against thugs. So if you say that, if that's coming from, places of politics, obviously, rap and hip hop has crossed a threshold where everybody who is directly affected by its contents got something to say. But I'm just simply saying, rap, and we're honest, it does talk about things that we disagree with, that's the truth of the matter. But that's not to say all rap is bad. We don't paint with a broad brush. We do have to stress, like I said, there are some things that we would disagree with from a criminal standpoint, from just the thing that has had, the impact that it's had on the community. Obviously those things need to be addressed.
Yeah. From my perspective, I lived on a rock. You have the expression, where did you grow up? Like, were you like under a rock or something? That's where I was, living on an island with very limited access to the world of America, right? This American Samoa is part of America, but it's way out there where nobody goes. Anyways, from our perspective on the island, I think in relation to this question, why is this genre of music regarded so negatively in society? I believe part of it is what has been made popular for us to see, right? For what is widely distributed as rap music is the songs that have the negative things in it. And so people would then draw their conclusion and paint with a broad brush and say, well, this is my experience, and they'll say things like, well, all the songs I've heard, there's nothing good in it, right? And so I think that's part of the reason why what is widely distributed and advertised as rap music versus the totality of hip hop culture, right?
I like that, Ron.
We do well to understand that, the criticism of this music, of this genre of music, while it is easier today, right? We need to understand that it didn't start today. Criticism of this genre of music has been going on since its origin. So, I was, talking to Key about this the other day. You think about an artist like, Grandmaster Flash. He got backlash for his song "Don't Push Me Because I'm Close to the Edge." I read those lyrics to Key, and I said, "Well, listen to the story that he's telling. This man is simply trying to tell a story about the environment that he is living in. You understand what I'm saying? And how it is a miracle that I haven't slipped and fallen off the deep end, considering the situation that I live in." So. Again, kind of going back to that first question, what it is, its origin, okay, there's always been if I can be frank, there's always been a tension between different cultures, right? And then, so if rap music is addressing some of those issues, talking about some of those things, it's easy to be dismissive of what the message is trying to tell you. You understand what I'm saying? If you just say, it's just something we shouldn't be listening to, it's riddled with foul language. No, we're telling the story, or it's telling the story. And it's saying, hey, here's what's going on. Can we talk about that? And so again, the criticism, the way I see it, man, it's really a easy way to be dismissive of the story that's being told.
Man, that was powerful, man. Key, what do you think about that?
I can't even put it more perfectly than what's been said. I just want to chime in with this. We've been using the term popular culture, you know, rap has gotten to the point where it is influencing everything. Even if you look at some of the country music now, you know what you hear in the country music? You hear an 808 drum and, yeah. and you hear auto-tune. All these things, well, auto-tune actually came from a box. The guy who invented auto-tune did not intend for auto-tune to be where it is today. Auto-tune was just pitch correction for when a person sings live. But now you have it that it has transitioned from the 80s to now today, and it's used in a lot of popular rap music. It has become vilified because, again, it is changing something that was said to be one way, but now it is become global. You have Chinese people who do hip hop and rap. You have people in Hawaii where Lima is. Now, you know, you can go all over the world. You just YouTube rap from all over the world and you will find that its influence has reached that far. Now, again, I will be dishonest if I said to you that some rap songs take things too far. I will be dishonest if I said, no, that's not true. Now, there are some songs that I can't support as a Christian that is rapping what it's talking about. But then there are, I can't just look at the whole thing and say, it's bad. I just can't throw it out. You know, you brought up Lecrae. Had to be in 2006. I actually met Lecrae. For those who know me, I produce music. I have been producing music since I was 14 years old. I have had two songs in the top 100 that I co-produced. Well, top 200, I should say, that I co-produced. Never got the big check, so that's why I'm still here broke. But that's besides the point.
How the game going, man?
Yeah, this is how it goes. But I remember when I first met Lecrae, he had there was a guy who was rapping with Lecrae, and his name was Flame, and he had a CD called Our World. And I can remember just talking with him and just like his passion for it. And again, it was down in Tuskegee, Alabama, is actually where I met him at. Had some friends who were attending school in Tuskegee, and I was nowhere near a Christian at that time. And so to hear the music that he was rapping. And he had bars, and I'm like, man, this dude is rapping, but he's not one cuss word. Now, mind you, again, I grew up in Mississippi. I'm 3-6 Mafia, Yo Gotti. You know, that was Lil Boosie, all because where we were, all the guys came to Mississippi. So that's all I knew. And it just blew my mind to hear that somebody could actually rap lyrics, and it would be over good beats, and he wasn't cursing. So, and that's my take. I'm like, man, you know, rap has become the thing. Like, it is it. Rap is going to be here. It solidified its place for a very, very long time.
Man, I love it. I love the take each of you guys had. Any other people want to add, maybe?
Yeah, I like what Lima said earlier about, you know, he was saying some of the backlash that it gets, you know, is you know, the artists that are getting the mainstream contracts. You know, the artists that you see first, you know, and so you think about the people who are behind those decisions, you know, who sign those deals, I mean, who make those deals, you know, that's a bigger problem. Again, you can't paint with a broad brush and say all of, you know, this entire genre of music is bad because of these mainstream artists over here. I'm telling you, for every mainstream artist that you can name, listen, there's thousands of underground artists and independent artists who are free from that message, you know, that the mainstream media is, you know, in front of. I appreciate that.
And not only that, you know, another thing you got to take in consideration that I've always thought about this. I mean, obviously it's different now because you got, you know, YouTube and different outlets. You can just upload your own music. You know, if you say your artists that are talking about the misogyny, the guns, the drugs, the crime, the criminal element, I've always said, man, 20, 25 years ago, man, somebody had to sit in a room and listen to them guys' demo tape. And say, man, we think this should be put out. Now, truth be told, the people who are making those decisions don't look like you and I. And so, you know, on one hand, so you can't say, you know, it's completely bad when there are a lot of powerful people who are making a lot of money off of this stuff and they're putting it out, but then turn around and say, well, you know, I don't like it. I don't let my children listen to it. And then another thing you got to think about too, you know, if we're going to compare genres of music and you're saying this one is just totally bad, we can't listen to it. with some of those same artists or on the same label with some of these other genres. And, you know, they in the studio crossing paths and stuff like that. And so, you know, it's just one of those things. Yes, we have to have a balanced view of anything, not just rap or sports, academics. But it just seemed like, you know, just if we all are honest, it seemed like anything where minorities are highlighted and at the forefront is always going to be looked at and deemed in a negative light.
Absolutely. And as thinkers and you know, make proper judgments. I know that's the other question here, but sometimes the inconsistencies is like irritating, you know.
And is I think part of that is what I want to get into next too. I think and Key, I'm going to start with you for this question because it was the post that you made on Facebook regarding the Super Bowl and the halftime performance that sort of again ignited that memory of starting this or doing an episode specifically on Christian entertainment and rap music. But before we get into that, I just want to give two things that I researched was number one, I think I sent this to Ron, but Candace Owens, I don't know how many of you guys know her, but you know, she's considered an American conservative author or political commentator, whatever you have her to be. But I think she tweeted that she enjoyed the halftime show and it was, you know, it was great, right? It was the best she's seen in a while, you know, like so many other people said. And then it was, you know, obviously read by her fan base and she went to try to, I guess, defend herself and say, hey, I actually listened to a country singer back on, you know, a Thursday night football game and he performed. And of course the guy who put this up was, you know, joking like, ah, oh, she had to look that up, man. There's no way that she actually remembered that. She had to go back and look it up. Whether she looked it up or not, I don't know. But her response would show that she thought there was some merit to what her fan base was saying about her and their displeasure with her listening to and liking the performance at the Super Bowl. One other thing that I saw, too, of course, like Keith stated in that particular post, a lot of people had a lot of things to say about rap music that particular day. I mean, it was front and center. I mean, everybody, Christians and all, especially Christians. One, I think it's the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry actually stated that a concern to many interested in the development and growth of teenagers is the negative and destructive themes of kinds of music, which they were balancing their approach. But they said of kinds of music such as rock, heavy metal, and hip hop, right? They believe that it causes, you know, things like drug and alcohol abuse because it's glamorized and suicide and sex with the focus on control of sadism and incest, you know, multiple other issues that they believe rap music is the cause for and, you know, other genres. But specifically for, you know, our conversation, we want to think about rap music here. What is the backlash that rap music receive? Is it a moral issue or is it a cultural issue? I'm going to start with you, Keith.
Part of me wants to say it's both, but and I'll give my reason why I will lean toward both, but the scale for me really tips toward a cultural thing. It's kind of like, and I want to say this with respect to our brethren who are not black or brown. It, again, it seems like whenever, as Cameron made the statement, it seems like whenever there's somebody who is not the norm, not the standard that does something, it gets this negative spin to it automatically. Because what I've seen a lot of our brethren classify the Super Bowl halftime show as the thug show. And I'm like, wow, like it wasn't a thug show when the Red Hot Chili Peppers was on stage naked and had women who were dressed in modest. And it wasn't the thug show when Shakira and Jennifer Lopez. It wasn't the thug show when it was Katy Perry. So we can go on and on. And as you can, me and Ron laughed about it last night. I told him the first thing I did was I got on YouTube and said, you know what? Let me look at these previous halftime shows because surely I could find some thug shows if I go look at these, if I go back and look at it. But again, now there is some music that I'm totally against. There's a lot of the rap today, I don't know none of these guys. A young boy NBA, old boy NBA, and whoever else NBA. I don't know. I can't tell you a lyric. I don't know any of the music, but there's a particular type of music called drill music. Me, as somebody who produces music for commercials, nursery rhymes, TV shows, for certain artists, everything I do is dealing with clean people who do good music. But what I see a lot of this drill music is that what they're talking about. So I can see somebody saying, well, this particular type of rap music should not be allowed, or that this particular type of rap music should be banned. But again, I can't just throw out the whole of rap music, because again, I can go to country songs and I can sing a few of them that promote promiscuity, I'm sorry, that promotes sex, that promotes drinking. No, I know everybody loves Willie Nelson. And what old Willie Nelson said, well, you know what, just have me a beer and a doobie, you know, and that's Willie Nelson right there. And Willie Nelson has been, guess what, on the Super Bowl stage and performing, you know, and he has been in several movies. And again, I'm not just picking on Willie Nelson, but I'm saying I want equal outrage. Again, if they red, yellow, black, or white, I want equal outrage. So to answer the question, like I said, I can see both, but again, if for some odd reason it just seems to blow up more whenever it's the black community that is the forefront. Because again, in a post that I made, I said it was nice to see the diversity. You had black, white, and a female. You had all these people who came from the gutter. And again, I said that these people were successful in the world's eyes. You know how many kids look up to a 50 Cent, despite what he's done in the streets, but look at what he's done. Man, he had shows on TV. He sold his vitamin water for so many millions of dollars. You think about Eminem, somebody, in my opinion, is the best rapper who has come through to do it. As far as writing a song and being able to come up with concepts, hands down. This guy came from Detroit, from 8 Mile, poor, impoverished conditions, and is able to get to where he is. Dr. Dre, from the world-class Wrecking Crew dancing to a pass with Death Row Records to now a successful mogul selling, you know. So I try to look at the whole thing, but again, sometimes people can't even get past that and just say, oh, well, they just thugs, you know, and they just label it just because of what was said in a song back then. But again, do I glorify the smoking, the drinking? No, I do not. I do not approve of those lyrics. But again, I need to have that same mindset when it comes to whether it be country, rock, pop, metal, whatever it is. I got to keep that same mindset.
Ron, what do you think about that question?
I was saying that my answer, it's similar to Keys. You know, there is a part of me that wants to say that there's a mixture of the two, right? But here's why I lean towards it being a cultural issue more so than a moral issue. The problem that you have from a moral standpoint, I guess, if you say you look at rap music, okay, here's what I don't like about it. Those problems exist in every genre of music. I mean, if you know, we wouldn't have time to go over, you know, the various songs that mention the same things that are vilified, in rap music. Again, going back to what I mentioned, there's always been tension between, you know, these different cultures, right? Rap being the vessel to voice those differences. So again, there's going to be hostility there. You know, as far as the halftime show, people labeling it, and I saw that myself, it's the thug show. Right, yeah, you glorifying these thugs on TV. You know, I said, wow, no, for me, that halftime show, it was just a trip down memory lane. You know, I was about, you know, 5, 6, and 7 when some of those songs came out. I can remember hearing them on the radio, songs that just made you nod your head. You know, so as far as, I guess, some of those songs, I guess people would say, hey, listen, we don't need to stand by this lyric. We don't need to stand by that lyric. Show of hands, if you watched the halftime show, which one of those songs were played during the halftime show? Which one? I didn't hear, you know, one song that, you know, that display, oh, listen, that's totally explicit and it shouldn't have been in that performance. Because guess what? The network wouldn't have broadcast it, right? So Again, it does kind of like Brother Freeman was saying earlier, it does kind of seem like whenever minorities, you know, take the, you know, the forefront of something, the backlash is greater.
Kate Talima?
I think for some people, it's it would be if they're the ones bringing the backlash, right? When you're talking about morality, now you're talking about racism, right? And some of the backlash is towards rap music because of where it originated, right? And so, if we're going to be completely honest about it, that's for most people. It's where it started and who it started with, the time America was in around that time, and that seed was planted way back then. And it's not like they used to love rap music and all of a sudden it's different now. It was always, from a moral standpoint, racism was at the root of it. From a cultural standpoint, some people just don't like it because it's not their type, it's not their thing, it's not their culture, it's not, you know, and so that's fine. But then the way they put it out there, here's why I don't like it. it you can clearly see it's more than just their preference. And so it comes back to morality again. why do you speak against it in such a way if that's just not your preference? Like, I don't like country music, but I don't go out my way to say, oh, country music is evil. You know what I'm saying? And so... So yeah, that's my viewpoint in regards to that question.
Okay, Cam.
Everybody that's spoken, man, just, you know, wonderful thoughts, wonderful comments. I'll just add to, you know, I look at it kind of as both, you know, cultural and moral. I say moral from the standpoint of some of the content of the lyrics, you know. They deal with moral issues, they deal with morality. But by that same token, dealing with things that deal with morality, you know, obviously when they talk about things dealing with morality, you know, those are things that the Bible condemns. But from a cultural standpoint, you know, I think Ron mentioned earlier about, you know, a lot of the music, I mean, pretty much all forms of music, you know, expressions of what people are feeling and facing and dealing with. So it just becomes a vehicle of expression. Even if you think about, you know, the content, I mean those elements exist in all types of entertainment, sports, music, movies. When the guys in hockey are fighting, literally fighting for real, when they are fighting, nobody is saying these guys are thugs. These guys are actually knocking people's teeth out. There's blood everywhere. We don't hop on social media and say, man, these are they shouldn't even be playing sports. We don't do that, man. So the labels are misplaced and just labeling all these guys thugs. If you disagree with their content and their music, you can't turn around and go and see the same content in movies and don't say anything. So what Key was saying earlier about, you know, man, let, you know, have the same outrage. Don't just have it because it's rap, but if it's in movies, if it's on television, have the same outrage. And so nobody's on this panel is justifying anything anybody does that's contrary to the will of God. But have the same viewpoint and same type of outrage and frustration across the board if you're gonna be fair and honest.
Right, man. I could not have agreed more with the responses to the question. Before we move to the next, are there anyone want to add anything to that question, or we good? All right, let's move to the next one. So this was a pretty big one too, as especially within my age group, most people want to know: can you be separate from the language that you used, or can you judge a person completely and totally off the language that they use? So. Just want to talk about this question. What about profanity in rap music? Like, what if the song is meaningful, but the language used is vulgar? So I'm gonna start with you, Ron. What do you think about that question?
Yeah, restate the question. You cut out there for a second.
Yeah, no problem. What about profanity in rap music? What if the song is meaningful, but the language used is vulgar?
You know, it depends on, man, I would say, how was you? Again, as we've been saying earlier, nobody is sitting here, you know, justifying these things against the will of God. But let's say you have an artist talking about an instance of being pulled over, let me just say this, by a police officer, going through the lyrics and just simply saying, okay, and as he had me up against the wall, he called me fill in the blank, okay? Could that person have found a better way to say that? Of course. But a lot of the artists that use that kind of terminology, man, they're just saying, hey, listen, I want to be raw, I want to be in your face, and I want to stay, listen, true to the details of whatever story I'm telling. So I would say at times, I think it has its relevance. Again, not, you know, campaigning for people to use that language loosely, but sometimes it has its relevance.
Okay, Talima?
Well, you know, we've all acknowledged this before, but across all genres of music, you also think about the context, not just the words or the profanity words, but also there's context in what is being said. Even though there's no curse word in there, what is the context of what is being said? Is it something that's, you know, immoral or moral? The way I feel about this part, this is where your Christian freedom and judgment for me comes in. We, of course, all of us understand we don't listen to, you know, to filth. We don't listen to profanity. We don't do all of that. I look at it this way. As preachers, right, part of our work is to reach the masses. What are you going to do as a preacher when you run into someone who curses like a sailor? You're going to write them off, right? You can, you know what? This person is already not a good person, so he's probably not a good candidate for the gospel. I'll move on to the next person. And for me, there's equivalence there, right? In everything in life, like, you have to use proper judgment as a Christian. What you're going to do with that individual who curses like a sailor, you're going to try and hear his story. And you're going to have some forbearance, or you might just say, hey, can you try not to curse? And they will try, and eventually something slips out. What are you going to do? Write him off? All right, so you're going to hear him out. You're going to try and understand who he is. And so sometimes that's how we approach music, right? We want to hear the story, but we already know as children of God, we're filtering out the filth, but we want to hear this story. What is he trying to communicate? Minus the filth, right? And again, that's not me trying to say or encourage anyone to listen to music with profanity. You can tell a meaningful story without it.
I like it, man. I like it. We're going to go to Key.
You know, that is a complex question. And I'm going to echo again what Cameron and Lima both have said. We don't encourage people to go out and do it, but I want to give you a scenario that I faced one time. As I give you my answer, I forgot what year it was that movie American Sniper came out. I had to be at the school of preaching because I remember arguing this with some brothers, and I brought the situation up that whatever something came out. I'm a huge Lupe Fiasco fan, and he came out with a song that was called "The B Word Bad." But the message of the song was that women should not have to be referred to as the B word in order for her to be considered as quote unquote bad or valuable. And I was like, man, the way he did that song, and I listened to it to say, man, you know, his take on that song was not what you thought it would have been. And man, they were mad. Oh yeah. But then a lot of them were like, hey, after school, we're going to go see American Sniper. Now, mind you, American Sniper probably had 150-something F-bombs in it. And so I was just like, man, you know, like help me see the logic in this. But again, when it comes to that, I will say if there's a chance you get an edited version of something, you find your edited version. But then also, you know, with me, And I'll say this, CeeLo Green came out with a song. I thought the name of the song was Forget You for the longest. I never knew it on the album. And when I heard the real song, I was shocked. I was like, oh, he's saying it's the real. I'm glad I didn't play this in front of my mama, you know, because I'm like, I remember a sister back in my home congregation in Mississippi. She thought the same thing. Like, I'm telling you, when I told her, I was like, look, don't listen to the dirty version. You make sure you keep listening to the clean version, because you know the song was a very catchy song. But again, if you happen to come across something that you can't find the clean lyrics, that's why I like things like Spotify and stuff like that. Because when you search with songs, you can search for the amended version, the clean version. But if you're gonna listen to it for the feel of just, hey, I want to see what this is talking about, I want to see the story, I would not fight with anybody about that. Now, again, I know the majority of the people, I'm speaking for the world now, that when it comes to music they listen to, they won't think cussing because, you know, that's the way that they talk. But we as Christians, you know, it's not in our vocabulary. It's not for us to talk the way that the world talks, or even, you know, participate in the things like that of the world. So, but again, you can't just say, hey, just because a person is rapping, that it's a sin, it's wrong, you shouldn't partake in it.
Cam?
Yeah, you know, and you know, when you start thinking about, you know, all of us are Christians, all of us are preachers, and we live in the world, so we're not isolated, you know, insulated, you know, from the world and what goes on in the world, what's said in the world. But, you know, being a Christian, and I think Lima mentioned about, you know, the transformation of what we used to listen to and stuff that we were subjected to, because we were in the world and we listened to rap, did all those things that the world does. But, you know, becoming a Christian, you do have to start, you know, unloading the baggage of things that you know, that hamper your relationship with God. And I'm just simply saying that, you know, it could be a popular song, catchy song, and sometimes even a radio almost cringe to say that part. You know, they didn't have to use that word, or they had to say that to make it, you know, make the song. The song was okay as it is. But by that same token, I would say, I think there's a big difference between listening and hearing. And so, you know, like, we hear everything. Like, we hear everything that's audible that we can hear. But listening is intentional. So, you know, for the person, for the young Christian, the new convert, for the person who is just coming to a knowledge of the truth, you know, we would encourage you, you know, don't listen or watch or do anything that's going to compromise your faith and your belief. But, you know, it's like, man, you hear stuff on commercials and you start thinking, I mean, like, when you watch TV for an hour, you know, you're going to see about 10 to 15 commercials. A lot of the commercials have the rap songs in the commercials. So it's like, man, if you are trying to basically say, I'm not going to listen to no rap ever, man, that's like, it's everywhere. And that's the problem. And what I was talking about earlier, it's direct, it's everywhere. And it's like, you can't avoid it now. And so what you have to do, as someone who is trying to live right before God, you have to determine in your own mind and heart, you know, what are you going to do? As Proverbs 4 says, about guarding your heart. And guarding your heart may mean that, like he said, you may have to find the edited version, or if it's something just a matter of conscience, you may not be able to listen to it at all. But, you know, there is profanity in,